bekommt, die nicht gefiltert sind. Und das ist eine Seltenheit heutzutage. Gut, das war's von mir. Ich übergebe erstmal das Wort an Annie Meschen und dann wird Dr. David Ray Griffin den Vortrag halten. Vielen Dank.
I just want to say a few words by way of introduction to the event. As Jens mentioned, I'm the tour organizer for the European leg of David Ray Griffin's spring tour. And he's, I think, doing 11 different cities over a period of about 20 days, with a little break in between. And the response across the continent has been amazing. I just want to say a few words about why I think it's so important that we continue to do this sort of work and put a bit of context around the 9/11 Truth Movement, the 9/11 Truth Campaign. I started out as a spy back in the 1990s. I worked for the British spy agency MI5, and then ended up leaving, resigning, and blowing the whistle on their crimes and incompetence. And when I say crimes and incompetence, we are talking big time crimes. They were conducting illegal investigations into politicians in the UK. They were allowing bombs to go off on British streets, which they could and should have prevented. And I even saw intelligence agencies involved in false flag terrorist attacks. I'm sure many of you are familiar with that concept. But when I say that, I mean that attacks happen, terrorism happens, and are blamed on one party, but are in fact carried out in secret by another. One very notable example of that in the 1990s was MI6, which is the UK James Bond type organization, being involved in planning and financing an assassination attempt against Colonel Gaddafi of Libya. That assassination went wrong, but innocent people died, and the operation was also illegal. So I ended up leaving the service, and with my ex-colleague and ex-partner, David Shaler, we blew the whistle on the spies. And I just raised that to show to you that false flag is a political reality. The dark stuff that the spies are reputed to do is a political reality. And I think it's worth bearing that in mind when addressing other big terrorist attacks. And of course, 9/11 is one that will be discussed today. But why is it so important to look at 9/11? This is an event that happened, obviously, in a different continent many years ago, and yet the repercussions are still affecting us globally today. We're looking, of course, at the event of 9/11 being the pretext for this unending war on terror. And that unending war on terror has inexorably led to two illegal wars in the Middle East to date, both Iraq and Afghanistan, with the possibility of further action in places like Iran. But we're also, as well, looking at 9/11 as a pretext for the shredding, destruction of our civil liberties and our human rights in our countries as well. I mean, in the UK, for example, we are seeing evidence coming out of the use of torture by the UK spies against terrorist suspects. We're seeing people being thrown in prison without trial. We are seeing activists on the streets protesting being arrested for no good reason, purely so the police can ascertain their identity. And we're seeing a whole string of other laws as well coming in, where, for example, in the state of national emergency, your homes in the UK can now be seized, your house can be seized and demolished, and you don't get any compensation, all in the name of protecting the state. So certainly in the UK, we are beginning to live in what looks like a police state, and this is all based on the fact of 9/11. But what if 9/11 is not all it looks to be? Of course, there is a mountain of evidence now that has come out from many, many experts, including, of course, David Ray Griffin, that contradicts the official account. And we have many professional bodies of people questioning the official account. We're looking at politicians for 9/11 Truth, architects and engineers. I know Richard Gage, the architect, was here a few months ago. Intelligence officers for 9/11 Truth, a whole range of different groups, all saying there is evidence that contradicts the official account, and we need a new and independent inquiry to get to the basis of that. Not just for justice for the victims on the day, and for the justice for the first responders who are sick because of 9/11, but also justice for those who have died in the Middle East as a result of the war on terror. And also to use a new account of 9/11 to halt the slide towards a police state that we're all facing. So I think it's a very important issue, and it's very central, a sort of exemplar of where a lot of things are going wrong with our political elites today. where the media can be spun and controlled, where the politicians can barefacedly lie to take us into war, and where we don't seem to have any real power over what our countries are now doing. So, as I said, there's a growing 9/11 movement across Europe. I've been privileged to have been part of helping to build that since 2005, when I picked up a copy of, ironically enough, Professor Griffin's The New Pearl Harbor, which was probably the earliest seminal work on 9/11 and the questions around it. And I read that book in one day, and I just thought, this is it. There are so many unanswered questions, we have to have a new inquiry. And since then, I've seen the UK movement burgeon. At one point, there were about 35 local groups going across the country. And since then as well, with speaking tours and other events, we've seen every country across Europe has at least one good 9/11 truth group. We're talking from the south of Spain up to Finland, from Russia down to Greece. It is a fast-growing global activist movement of people who are concerned and angry about what's being done in our name. So welcome, all of you, for coming, and thank you very much, especially to those who are new to this issue. You're in for a treat today, where Professor Griffin will be going through the evidence, the very strong evidence, that we need a new inquiry for the justice for us all. So without more ado, I'd like to introduce Professor David Ray Griffin. Thank you very much.
Guten Tag. Mindful that English is the second or third language for many of you, I will try to speak langsam und deutlich. My lecture is called 9/11, Time for a Second Look. In suggesting that it is time for people to take a second look at 9/11, I have in mind primarily people who decided long ago that the attacks of 9/11 happened essentially the way the Bush-Cheney administration and the official reports about 9/11 said they happened, and who therefore decided that the so-called 9/11 truth movement, which disputes that account, is comprised of crazy conspiracy theorists with no capacity to evaluate evidence objectively. Having formed these views long ago, such people, including most journalists, have been impervious to any arguments presented by the truth movement. They simply roll their eyes and move on. However, both the truth movement and the available evidence have changed dramatically in the past 3 years. Because of these changes, it is not rational to reject the claims of the movement out of hand without taking a second look. If you are a person who has had such an attitude, you cannot, in the face of these changes, simply roll your eyes without exhibiting the very irrationality of which you may charge people whom you call conspiracy theorists. My lecture is also addressed, albeit indirectly, to fellow members of the truth movement. Some of these members have decided that, now that Bush and Cheney are out of office, and the Obama administration has reversed some of their 9/11-based policies, that getting the truth about 9/11 revealed is no longer so important. Other members of the movement, seeing that the Obama administration is still presupposing that Al-Qaeda attacked America on 9/11, have concluded that there is no hope that this truth will ever be revealed, so we might as well give up. To such people, I suggest that getting the truth revealed is just as important as ever, because many 9/11-based policies, as Annie has just indicated, especially the war in Afghanistan, have not been reversed. I also